Thank you very much to the Asian American Research Institute for hosting us tonight. We're very excited to be here to talk about our research. It's been a fascinating project that we've gotten into. I'm personally delighted to be back at ARI. And so I've talked before again about Fuzhounese immigration, about Fuzhounese religious communities in New York and in China. I always want to give an acknowledgement to my dissertation advisor, Peter Kwong, who my first semester in grad school understood that I was interested in religion and immigration and China, and we talked about the Fuzhounese, and he said, get involved, get that project, jump on it now before somebody else gets it first, because it's great. And it's turned out to be an amazing 17-year project for me since I started grad school, learning more about the Fuzhounese immigration process and learning about Fuzhou, the out-migration process. And we'll talk a little bit about that tonight. My colleague, Professor Liang, is a recent hire at Baruch College, and I'm delighted that she's joined this project. As you'll see, she's a sociologist with very strong quantitative skills. I'm an anthropologist. I like to hang out and talk to people. Mm-hmm. And Ka has been teaching me how to count people also. I think between the two of us, we bring different perspectives, but it certainly added to my understanding of what's going on. So tonight we want to introduce a new chapter in the Fuzhounese immigrant story as we've experienced it. This is the story of Fuzhounese immigrant children, many of them immigrants themselves, who have begun to show up at Baruch College in increasing numbers over the last 5 years or so. 10 years ago, when I started teaching at Baruch, it was very unusual to find a Fuzhounese student, maybe one or two in a class, even in a large class. I always teach a large intro to cultural anthropology with 115 students. That's completely changed. This semester, my jumbo class of 115 students, I have 11 students from Fuzhou. That's a huge number. I'll just introduce them to you visually. Let's see if I can do that. Will that show up anyway? So there's my class, my intro class. They kindly can I show the slide from the beginning? Let's try that. They kindly agreed to be photographed for the presentation tonight. Baruch is known in the U.S. It's been reported in U.S. News and World Report for the last 7 or 8 years as the most diverse college campus in the country, which I think also makes it the most diverse college campus in the world, probably. Mm-hmm. But we have students from well over 100 nations, and a class like this is completely representative of that incredible diversity. So within that, then I asked, that's a little closer up of some of the students. And then I asked the Asian students in the classroom to hang out for another picture. So these are all the students who identify themselves as Asian. That's about 35% of the Baruch student population. They're just gorgeous. And then these are my Fuzhounese students. There were only nine who could stay after class out of the 11. That's a little introduction to them. Which one is my next one? This one? Yeah. Can you slide show from the beginning? I don't know what's going to be there. All right. So I do want to take a moment also to introduce Susan Wong, who's in the back. Many of you all know Susan. She's one of the directors of ARI. But Susan also is a counselor at Baruch College, an advisor in what we call the SEEK program, S-E-E-K. I don't know what that stands for.
Education, Elevation, and Knowledge.
Search for Elevation, Education, and Knowledge. And it's a program that is designed to provide extra support for college success for students from economically disadvantaged families. So Susan's been an incredible part of this research project, and we want to involve her in the Q&A because she's meeting and working with students, particularly from Fuzhou, on a daily basis. So a couple of years ago, the director of the SEEK program, Angie Anselmo, approached me at a faculty meeting and said that she had just been on a retreat with the student leaders from SEEK, and they had expected during the student retreat to have to work through all kinds of tensions across racial and ethnic lines. They were expecting to have to deal with tensions between blacks and Hispanics and whites and Asians, and what they found actually was that the tensions that they were dealing with were within the Chinese community. And that they began to identify and realize that they had a much more diverse Chinese population in their leadership team than they had anticipated. And so one of the realizations was that there were quite a few Fuzhounese in the SEEK program. And Angie asked if I could help her understand better the educational experiences and the immigration background of the Fuzhounese. So we've embarked on a study that now we've surveyed over 100 Fuzhounese students at Baruch, and we're going to present some of our findings tonight. We'll consider this a workshop, so we'll present some of our findings, some of our initial thoughts about those findings, and we'd be delighted for your insights as we go along. Let's see. So in a few minutes, Professor Liang will present some of that data that we've gathered. But let me begin. Many of you all may be familiar with the background story, but I want to just say a few words of background because as we've analyzed the data, understanding the context in which these students have come from to Baruch College is really essential. It's important to understand their immigration journey. It's important to understand their community's journey. So we hope that our study will add to we'll do several things. One is that it'll help Baruch understand Fuzhounese students and provide services better, also within the CUNY community at large. We hope that it will continue to unpack this notion of Chinese Americans so that we can begin to see it in deeper complexity. And then we also hope to contribute to the theoretical debates around educational attainment, assimilation through education, because we believe we have a unique population here, and they have a unique set of challenges. They also have some unique strategies for mobilizing social capital, and those strategies are both end up being a strength and an obstacle in some ways. So just to make sure we're all on the same page about this, about 30 years ago, a very large-scale migration began from the towns and villages outside of Fuzhou, China. There's my book. That's a little gratuitous slideshow for you. So for those of you who don't have a map of Fuzhou in your mind, oops.
Can you just click?
Okay, there we go. So Fuzhou is there. You can relate it to Beijing and Hong Kong. And then this is a map of the surrounding areas. About 85% of the folks that I've surveyed in previous years have been from outside of Fuzhou City. They've been from towns and villages. So this out-migration of people who have been fishermen, farmers, rural peasants, a few sailors who got involved in the sea trade out of the port of Fuzhou, but this out-migration has emptied as much as 70% of the villages into a global migration. And the global migration is facilitated by a multi-billion dollar smuggling industry that's driven by human smugglers that we call snakeheads in Chinese, Shuto. And so the destinations include Japan, Australia, Eastern Europe, France, England, a few South American countries, but the primary destination has been New York City. And there's a question.
Yeah, I just want to know the question. Should we wait for your finish, or we can ask within the
PPT? If you don't mind, let's just... if it's urgent and I've completely confused you, then stop me and help me make it clear. But if you don't mind the big questions, let's go to the end.
Okay.
If you don't mind, thanks. So this is a picture of Fuzhou downtown. There's your McDonald's and your Kentucky Fried Chicken. The primary activity in the villages today is still fishing and farming, though very few of the local Fuzhounese farm. They're mostly internal migrants from South and Southwest China who are now there. Weddings, I'll go back and say religious festivals are another big part of the economic scene, as well as funerals. Funerals pump so much money into the local economy, and remittances are the underlying source of that. So these are just some pictures from the local community. This is one of the small villages where I do research. It's not so small anymore, as you can see from the large buildings. Those are houses, almost all of them empty, built by with remittances sent back from New York. You can see that, yes. It's, sure, Fuchi. It's across, it's in Changle, across from, near the bridge going to Langqi Island, if you actually know the area.
Because I want to make sure it's a different town than where my parents
come from. Oh. all right. So the migration to New York, what we've seen in New York City is a complete transformation of Chinatown and the Chinese community. We've really seen a revitalization of Manhattan's Chinatown and the creation of a very dynamic Chinatown, a satellite Chinatown rooted in Sunset Park that's now extending south into Bay Ridge and Fort Hamilton. This is an incredible transformation of that neighborhood in Brooklyn as well. So some of my earlier writing is focused on how Fuzhounese have been fitting into Chinatown, looking at the notion of an ethnic enclave as a place where immigrants live and work in ethnic businesses. And certainly when I started this research back in the mid-1990s, that's the role that Chinatown played, was a gateway city for Fuzhounese coming in. And most of the work was in the New York City metropolitan area. But since that time, the role of Chinatown within the Chinese Fuzhounese community has been transformed. And this street, East Broadway, has become a key part of the storyline. And so my discussions now are not so much about an ethnic enclave, but now it's about the hub of a national ethnic economy of Chinese restaurants. So if you, I always ask my students if they order in Chinese food, and they all say yes. So I said, well, you've met somebody from Fuzhou. Because most of the Chinese delivery guys in New York City are from Fuzhou. But now, if I travel around the country, I can also say, have you been to an all-you-can-eat Chinese buffet restaurant lately? All-you-can-eat $9.99 Chinese buffet, or ordered in from a small takeout Chinese restaurant. And people will raise their hand. I said, well, you've probably met somebody from Fuzhou also. Now, that whole national network of Chinese restaurants is mobilized from East Broadway. So on East Broadway, you have all the kinds of immigrant services and entrepreneurial supports that you need to make this happen. Is that me? Should I move my mic lower? I hear a humming. Is that bothering you?
I'll lower.
Okay. So anyway, just quickly, you see Western Union. So if you make money, you can send it home. MoneyGram, all kinds of billboards all over the place. People looking for... what does that look like? A single room for rent in the big letters there. A driving school if you need to learn to drive. And tons of employment agencies that place people in jobs around the country. Obviously, there's a very dynamic and vibrant market. When you walk by these markets, you realize there's a significant difference between East Broadway and Mott Street. I think in the popular American imagination, Mott Street is Main Street in Chinatown. But I think in recent years, it's become more almost like Disney World Main Street, in that it's a place to sell things, restaurants and small knick-knack shops to tourists. And so East Broadway, I think, in many ways has become the dynamic center of the contemporary Chinese population. And then you begin to see places to buy tickets for buses, New York to Toledo, New York to Michigan, wedding centers. Fuzhounese are come back to New York City to get married. Hometown associations. This whole building at number 2 East Broadway is just full of hometown associations. Little religious temples. This is a Taoist temple. All along East Broadway. So my last couple of comments about this is that what I've been looking at recently in this regards are the bus lines and employment agencies that are providing the capital and movement for these to serve these restaurants. And so you all know about Feng Hua and buses like that are running the New York Boston, New York Washington lines. But there are also and maybe you know about the inner city buses that run from Chinatown, Manhattan to Sunset Park and to Flushing. It's an incredible entrepreneurial story in and of itself. And then these employment agencies. So people go in, they find jobs that may be posted in Wisconsin or Texas or Florida or Maine. There's a phone call made to the owner. If it's a match, then they find out about a bus line that goes there. And they may travel. These are cards for all the bus companies that particular employment agency facilitates, and then over the course of the day, it's very different than the New York Boston, New York Washington lines. These lines really just run Chinese workers. So these are you can see some of the destinations, but all over Chinatown you find little bus stops. It's quite a debate within the community about buses and on the curbs, but 7 days a week. And some of these buses are legal, but they're unmarked. I found 12 different bus companies that just run restaurant workers from Manhattan out to across the country. So it's a very, very dynamic street, and it's a very, very dynamic community. And this is part of the background that we are experiencing with our Chinese students at Baruch. The ethnic economy is circulating workers who happen to be their parents between New York City and restaurants all around the country. And their families are severely affected by this, and their own personal experience of study is affected this way. Their families, our students' families, are new immigrants. They're primarily rural folks from towns and villages. They're really poor, on their way here. Many of them are undocumented. Many of them are in debt. We'll see very low education background, almost no English, and really no experience in an urban environment or economy. So the transition into New York is really incredibly extreme. They are functioning, though, in this ethnic economy, largely, and that's an entry point for them and a way of supporting the family and getting a beachhead into American economy and American society. But folks are working very long hours. They're working for low wages. They're constantly on the move. They're very vulnerable because of their legal status. And oftentimes, their primary networks are within the Chinese community and may be even more exclusively within the Fuzhounese community. So I think that's the context. The question we're looking at is how are we getting so many folks from this context? How many are we getting so many young people, students, into Baruch College? Where are they, what's the trajectory here? How do they end up at Baruch, one of the premier senior public colleges in New York and consistently on a national basis? How do we understand their success? So maybe that's the point. I'll turn it over to Ka and we can begin to show you some of a picture of these students at Baruch. I didn't take too long.
Before you go into that, what is the population or the count that we're talking about? So you're saying this town in Fuzhou, like 70% has migrated overseas. What's the population of that town and what percentage of that is in New York City?
Sure. The folks in the town say 4,000 people are on the official registry. 3,000 of them are not there. Mm-hmm. And that's not just that town. That's like all the towns and villages outside of Fuzhou. So in Fuzhou, the latest report I saw, a governmental report said 500,000 people have left. Not all of them have come to New York. But when you ask the Fuzhounese American Association, they'll say, they told me 8 years ago that it was 300,000 of them had come to New York. Now, they may not all be in New York, right? They're circulating. In fact, the buses that I estimate there are between 50 and 60,000 restaurant workers circulating through the system at all times. Mm-hmm. So it's a very, very heavy migration.
What's your estimate
for the population of
New York City?
Nobody is counted. So are there a couple hundred thousand Fuzhounese in New York City? That's pretty easy to think. We haven't done a total survey of Baruch, but we have 12,000 undergraduates at Baruch. And if I'm starting to see 7 to 8% of my classes being Fuzhounese, that means there may be there may be 800 or 900 Fuzhounese students at Baruch College. I'm not sure. That may be a little high, but it's also possible. Now that we have 20 CUNY campuses, Baruch, we think, is a particular destination because of the particular kinds of degrees we're getting and the strategies that people are using to use education as a ladder up. A lot of folks are not counted by the census because they're undocumented and people won't participate. So it's also it's hard to get numbers. I know people like numbers for their stories. When I write a story, it's nice to have numbers. But that's the best I can do today. Is that helpful? Is that helpful?
Yeah.
Sorry.
Okay, thank you very much, Ken. Okay, now let me have a very quick introduction on our master's use and the data we collected. This is truly a master research. We collected both qualitative and quantitative data for our study. Back in the year of 2010, we were able to initial a small survey in order to investigate the general need and the special challenges among our Fuzhounese students. And with the very generous support from the diversity grant from CUNY and also the big help from the SEEK program, and we were able to develop a questionnaire that covers information including the students' personal background information, their family situation, their initial needs when coming to school, their school performances, and of course their cultural experience at Baruch College. Well, we were a little bit worried at the beginning how to recruit our respondents, because even this is a growing population at Baruch, but still compared to how large the university and the student body is, this is still a relatively small, actually very small group, right? And so we forwarded our flyer to our colleagues, and we posted in a different classroom in our building, and we introduced the project to our students, and also from a SEEK program where Susan and her students are very, very helpful. And when we finished this survey last semester, we end up with collecting information from 102 students. I know this is not a big number, exciting, very large sample data from the perspective of a traditional qualitative researcher, but truly consider how many students we're having at Baruch. This is a very reasonably strong information that we can use, especially when we want to use this data for some prescriptive analysis that show our very first image of this group. And now we can see some very quick summaries about our respondents here. We have around 52% of the respondents who are females, and only 13% of all the students were born in the U.S. But if you look at the immigration status they reported, we can see we have almost 40% of the students who are currently the citizens, and another 40% are permanent residents. And we do have 20% of our respondents who refuse to answer this question. And with all the background, knowledge from Ken, we have certain confidence to anticipate many students in this category were from the undocumented family or still keep this status today. And the age, average age for our students are almost 23 years old. That is the current age they have, considering this study initiated 2 years ago. So when they entered the project, they were around 21 years old. Okay, because many of the information, especially the immigration-related information and the school performance measures were self-reported variables. We realized that there is a possibility for report bias. That is why we introduced an additional quantitative study from the Office of Institutional Research at Baruch College. Also, on the top of all this quantitative data, Professor King Guest conducted a very long and rich study on the qualitative side, and now we have very rich data in terms of the in-depth interviews we conducted with the students and the participant observation and the field work in the local Fuzhounese community. So based on all this data, we have this, the following story that we want to share with you. First, let's start from the family. What kind of family the students were living in, and their what kind of family background they are bringing into this college? Okay, in the current literature in sociology and in education, all support a very strong correlation between the family background in terms of socioeconomic status and the students' educational attainment and educational performance. Also, the parents' aspiration to students is another strong predictor for how far they can go in the school system. So let's look at how the school, how the Fuzhounese parents or Fuzhounese family are doing in terms of this dimension. Okay, this figure shows us the parental education attainment for our students. We can see that very, very few parents actually have a degree, a college degree. Do you have a question?
Mm-hmm. I was afraid that when you finish my question, I forgot.
Mm-hmm. Of course.
Mm-hmm. My question is based on your data. And in the beginning, I heard you say that your research, like based on the Fuzhounese student in the Brook and the community, most in the old Chinatown, right, in the East Broadway, or whole New York City.
All wherever these, it's...
Here you mentioned 8th Avenue, because 8th Avenue is dirty Chinatown. Over there, I have a very grow big group of Fuzhounese.
Yeah, I did mention Sunset Park in my introduction,
actually,
and that's...
Area. Actually, it's the McKinley Park area. Because I'm the Brooklyn Public Library, I was a manager of the McKinley Park Library. So
okay, I don't want to argue about that, but
I
will be very clear. We're talking about Fuzhounese at Baruch, and they're from many different parts of New York City. They're primarily from 8th Avenue, if you'd like, and neighboring areas in Brooklyn, as well as Lower Manhattan and other areas. Go ahead.
Okay, so let's continue with this graph on the educational attainment for Fuzhounese parents, and we can see the typical school grade they attained was below or equal to high school. There were further blue bars that indicate the father's education. That's slightly better than what we can see for the mothers. And for the fathers, there is a group around 25% or so have less than elementary school education. In junior high school and high school together counts for the major group that we can see here. And for the mothers, things are slightly different here. But the general trend is we see very, very few Fuzhounese parents are having the college education. And even the high school education is not the majority for this group. Now let's look at how this compare to the rest of the American Asian American population. Okay, in this figure, you can see still the same features from the previous page, but there is a new new blue bar. This blue bar indicates the general educational attainment for Asian American adults, nationally speaking. The data was from 2008, a survey from the national population. And we can see, on average, around 50% of all Asian American adults in this country have a degree from college. And how about the high school degree? If that is one of the majority major credential our Fuzhounese parents have, this blue bar shows 85% of all Asian American adults today have at least a high school education, right? During this comparison, we can see the Fuzhounese parents here really have a relatively low educational level. As showed from the figures. Okay, how about the other measures for socioeconomic status? We know when we asked for what is the occupation for your parents, typical answers we got were from, for example, movers, chef, sales. In general, we get occupations as labor rather than the professionals. And there were a few students who reported their parents are the owners for some of the small businesses. But if you look at the family income, you can see we do not have a direct measure on how much money they can earn each year. But we know currently more than 85% of all the Fuzhounese students are receiving Pell scholarship. That is a federal aid provided to the students who have undergraduate students who have a high unmet financial need. In order to receive this scholarship, the students will need to show the evidence that they are from a family have an annual income less than 50K. And also, I want to emphasize, because we can track the history of students' reception, their records in terms of Pell scholarship, we can see most of the students, they receive this scholarship constantly for multiple terms. In other words, they were from the relatively poor household, and their economic condition maintained at a very low level for a long time. Okay, we also want to see how much involvement the parents can provide for their students. We know, as Ken mentioned previously, this doing very hard work on this labor occupation, and many of the parents have to work for long hours and were not able to provide many coaching or advising to the students depending on the schedule of them and the capacity of understanding local policies and culture. And also, we can see the Fuzhounese parents has a really very moderate aspiration for their students' future educational attainment. Around 10 or even more than 10% of our parents who never expected their kids can get into a senior college. That's not so usual if you look at the survey results from the general Chinese American population. And 35% or so of our Fuzhounese family feel that they can see their students can get through the college education, but only less than half of the parents expect that the students can go to the graduate school, and many of them haven't even thought about how far they want the students to go in the school system. Okay, so far we can see from the large picture of the higher education or the education and family situation in this country, especially this glory of model minority story for Chinese American and Asian American in general, we can see Fuzhounese group is really living in the shadow of this glory. It's not the typical typical representatives for the model minority. Their parents, our students, their parents were from relatively lower classes and doing very hard work and provide very limited financial and cultural support for them in terms of surviving and getting into the next level of the school. And they do not provide stereotypical Chinese or Asian parenting style, like the recent Tiger Mom discussed, that they do not push their student, their kids to practice piano or even do the housework or do the schoolwork. Right. So seriously, what can they offer to the students? Do they help the students at all? This is what we can see from a different angle for the family supports. Okay, if you look at the household arrangements, we can see a very, very high percentage, almost 75% of our students are living with both of their parents. Even this is given the fact that many of the parents, they are working and some of them have to work in different places. So this number is pretty, pretty high. And another 15% or so students live with at least one of the parents, and the small percentage living with at least some of the adult's parents. In other words, they were really provided with a very caring household environment, and they are supervised in terms of their schoolwork work and general behavior. That is...
I'd just like to comment on this, that one of the things that when we do the, both the qualitative and the quantitative work here is that while these students are reporting that they live with both parents, that doesn't mean that both of their parents are in the household all the time. It may be that they're both associated with the household, but one of them is working in a restaurant somewhere else in the other place in the country. So while it's showing a two-parent household, it doesn't mean that we have two parents on site all the time.
And it may not be necessarily a caring environment as well. I mean, the stresses that these parents live under is tremendous.
And we know that a lot of folks are living in multi-family dwellings, also with extended kin in the same household. So it's a very complicated situation. It's not your suburban house with two parents and a dog and a yard and two professional parents.
Even with all these limits, and in a few minutes, you can see that the students do reported a perceived closeness with their family.
I just have a question. When you say Chinese, I think it's it's better if you clarify for me. When you say Chinese American families, how do you define that? Because sometimes when I read newspapers, the way the author defined it could be slightly different from one person to another.
That's a very tricky question, because if you see in the past few decades and how much changes the census survey has made in terms of options they provided for what is your race or ethnicity, right? And many people today still feel very hard to choose a option that can fit for their own situation. Well, I think in the public and in academic world, people use this term Chinese American very loosely and very ambiguously. Here for us, when we indicate the Chinese American family, we indicate Chinese American families that is widely considered as the first generation, first and half generation, including second generation or even further. Okay, and even we know that the Fuzhounese household generally can provide relatively limited financial support compared to other Chinese American household in general, right? They do work very hard to provide resources so the kids can really engage in schoolwork. Here we can see, of course, many of our students receive the Pell Scholarship, but except that, the CUNY financial aid is another major contributor for the tuition and living cost for our students. Next to that, the family and parents still remains as one of the major contributors, right? And because of all these efforts, you can see our Fuzhounese students not typically have a work, especially full-time work, while they are studying. Right now, in our sample, there is only around 4% of the students are full-time worker, and we do have a 48% part-time worker who conducted less than 20 hours work every per week. But this is really a low percentage for the Baruch students, who typically all have certain type of work while they are in school. Okay. In this page, we are showing another two different support support that family can provide. For example, the Fuzhounese parents cannot provide a lot of coaching to schooling for the students, but they are also very influential in terms of the school decision for our students. And later in this presentation, I can show you that when we ask the students, how did you hear Brooke? And of course, we're not surprised if we see the answer from the students like, oh, I heard this from my friend or from the high school counselor. But the parents remain as of one of the very top answer here. And the parents, even they have limited access to the local culture and local resources, but they manage to understand the schooling system and try to help the students make a better decision. Of course, another reason why many of the students were coming to Brooke and because they and their family are pursuing for an education in business in particular. And right now we see almost 70% of our students majored in business. Only less than 10% have a major in the liberal arts, and there are still a 20% or so students haven't made up their mind. We see this as really a strategic approach for the family and for the students to achieve an upward mobility after their graduation. Okay, just let's come back to another type of support the family can provide. Just now, people asked, if not both of the parents are always showing up in the household, how much influence that can give to the child? Actually, we see the students did report a very high level of perceived closeness for the family. And this is only one of the many questions we raised in our survey. Do family members feel very close to each other? And we see as this, the frequencies increases, and we can see the respondent rate also increases. And also, we have measures on how they see the importance of family and how frequently the family has some activities or time spent together, and we also see very similar trend than what I can show here. Okay, so far we talked about the family supports the students received. Now let's look at in school what's going on and what is the school experience for our students. The first very interesting story we found here is the students generally share a very, very strong culture identity. And they also showed a kind of culture isolation. Okay, let's look at first in this table. And there is a measure on the perceived culture identity asked to the students. And we can see the red words represents the top two answers from our students. 41 students believe they are Chinese. Remember, all those categories are mutually exclusive, meaning the students can only choose one out of this list of the answers. Right? When they choose, I see myself as a Chinese, they cannot choose, I also see myself as a Fuzhounese or Chinese American. And 41% of them believe they're Chinese, and almost 40% of the students believe they are Fuzhounese, not Chinese American. I'm only Fuzhounese. And another 14% of the students believe they are Chinese American, and only 1%, that is one person, one person said, I think I'm American. Right? And remember, we have 13% of them born in this country and living, growing up in this country. And we do have Confucians. 5% of them never really know how to define themselves, but still think about how confusing this question is. This is to the adults and to adolescents in general. And we were really surprised that they are very calm and they truly have a very clear defined self-image in terms of the culture they belong to. Okay, now let's look at what kind of language they use by which we want to approach the type of culture isolation they showed. The top one most frequently used language outside the classroom is Mandarin, 54%. And the top two most frequently used language with their friends or in the public is English, not very surprising. And there are around 12% of people say they always speak Fuzhounese, right? And if we move to the primary language they actually use in the household, meaning the language they use when they talk to their immediate family or the person who they live with, we see almost 60% of them always speak Fuzhounese, and another 20% of them speak Mandarin only. Okay, how about their friendship and their social network? We also want to see when they have a very clear culture identity and how their social network is going. This figure, we have four bars from the bottom that shows the racial and cultural identity for their significant others, and then their best friend one, best friend two, and three. First, I want ask you to look at this black part, meaning not applicable. Around 45% of our students, remember, they're 19 years old, 20, 21 years old, they're not dating, they do not have a significant other. What's going on here? And how about the friendship? It's much easier to report a friend, but we do have students who had a hard time in reporting having three friends, two friends, or even one friend, right? Okay, this blue bar to the far left is Fuzhounese, meaning that their significant other or friend is Fuzhounese. We can see the second color here indicate Chinese or Chinese-American non-Fuzhounese. And then the very pale blue color here indicate Asian-American non-Chinese. We can see if we can combine these three colors together, that takes almost the majority, overwhelming majority of any reported significant others and best friends, right? You can find their friendship and their relationship limited to this small circle that share a very similar culture with them. We already mentioned Baruch College as the most diverse culturally most diverse campus in this country, probably in the world, right? And those students, Fuzhounese students, when they hang out with people, you can see a very high culture concordance between the different parties. And they are not really experiencing this cultural diversity in this school, right? Very interesting. Okay, now let's look at other school experience we can find from our respondents. We do see that many of them did engage in the curriculum, but they are not so involved in the extracurricular activities. For example, only 45%, less than half of students ever joined any of the students' club on campus. And we do have two days during the weekdays, Tuesday and Thursday, during the lunch hour, actually more than lunch hour, between 12 and 2:30. And that's a club hour, and there is no class scheduled. Anything the faculty can do is to prepare class or to go to faculty meeting, and students are all go to clubs. And we have a really very big part of our students are not really involved in these events happening twice a week. Okay, the students also showed a really unbalanced package. We want to see what kind of skills the students brought into the college after they graduated from the high school. And if we see the high school score, okay, the left part is a so-called verbal skills that's based on their performances on English or foreign language. And the right part, that is a so-called non-verbal skills, typically is the math performances or performances in science courses. We can see the students, when they are graduating, their high school average English score is 60. See, the similar, 62 for foreign language. And how about their math? 72. Well, it's higher than the English score, but not as impressive when we expect really high grade from math for Chinese students in general, Chinese American students in general, right? And similar score, 70 for the science courses. Okay, how about the SAT score? They do a little bit better in terms of SAT, especially for the math. There is an average score of 638 brought into the college, and compared to that, this verbal score is considered as low, 451. right? Mm-hmm. And when we asked the students to rank their English capacities, we actually did not really get very low self-reported score, and they may rank themselves as score 7 or 8 out of a score 10, meaning 10 is a high capacity and 1 is low capacity. But when they report the major challenges they have, they do recognize that the English barrier, language barrier, and the culture barriers are one of the major difficulties they experience in school. Okay, so far, we see an image of Fuzhounese students. Well, in the school, they are isolated in terms of culture, language, and social networks. And they also showed this big challenge from the English or verbal skills. But is this all that they can offer for the in terms of school performances and educational assessment? Definitely not. We actually found a really very high school performance as measured by the cumulative GPA from Baruch College. First, we collected data from the self-reported information, and we see a general GPA of 3.27 out of 4-point scale, right? We were like, wow, this is really high. Well, what's going on? Let's find out more. That's one of the major reasons why we introduced the institutional research data. That's the official record we can have. Actually, we have even higher numbers from that, average GPA of 3.30 out of 40. Okay, why we see a higher record from the official documents? One of the reasons is when we collected this self-reported GPA that was happened during the survey, right, 1 year or 2 years ago. And when we collected information on the official GPA that has happened in this summer. In other words, we have one or two more semesters counted in this cumulative GPA. We are not only see the students who really perform in their first year and second year, and they actually can maintain a very high GPA or even improve over time. Right? That's very significant. And if we transfer this GPA into a letter grade at Baruch College, and we can see more than 50% of the students are A students or A minus students. And our B students are almost 40, and we do have one person have a GPA slightly, almost a 2.0. That's a D plus student, and small number of students are C students. And isn't that surprising, right? At Baruch College, this is considered as really a high performance. Mm-hmm. Okay, what else do they have? They have a strong culture identity. They also have a very positive self-image. And we generated a 10-item test on the self-esteem. We can see the questions were raised to measure how satisfied they are with themselves or with the group, social group they belong to, and also if they feel they can contribute to the society or they feel they are popular in a opposite sex group. And we found really very positive responses, and there is an average of 34.45 out of a 50 scale. Okay, what I want to mention is this self-image, what is their self-image? First, they are imagining themselves as a student, as an individual, but also they consider the social and cultural background they are bringing into this context. They are a member of the local Fuzhounese community, and they are also a member of Baruch College, a senior college of City University of New York, and both contribute to a very positive self-image, and that is showing this confidence after a successful upward mobility. And they do perform better than their parents in terms of education, and they probably have a good chance of continuing to expand this success.
Do we have similar figures of other ethnic group or the average Americans or average Chinese Americans?
That's a very good question, and that's the data we really want to get. And in our survey, because we only include Fuzhounese students, we do not have an identical question offered to the rest of the Baruch students. But we do know that this is not the measure that I generated and can generate it ourselves. This is a measure used widely in the current literature, and I do not have an average number in my mind, but I can tell you that according to my knowledge about the previous use of this measure, this is considered as a relatively high score.
SAT figure you showed?
SAT score.
Yeah.
Yes. Can do. Can you?
Yeah. What's your question is?
The SAT
is, where does it?
Showed a verbal skill. There is a 400 or something. Mm-hmm. A figure of other athletic groups.
What is the general SAT for the Brooks students compared to?
I don't know.
To
Susan may
students.
Know better.
Well, you see, there is an admissions policy when students coming into Baruch College, so they have to have certain level of skills before we admit them. So the 450 is more or less average for most of the Chinese American students.
Mm. But it's not average across the board at Baruch. What's interesting here is the differentiation between the verbal score and the math score. So what we know about CUNY is that the admissions are decided by SAT scores, and so if you hit 1050 or if you hit 1100 at Baruch, you get admitted. That's somewhere right around in there, So what's interesting is that this student population has strategically found a way to hit that 1100 mark with a very low verbal score. So to have a 450 verbal and a 650 math is an unusual balance in the general population, but it is a strategy for admission, which is being utilized by this population.
Yes.
Yeah, I just wondered, the students in Brook, are they most of them born in China or United States? Or the elementary school in China, or some other first 5 years and after?
Yes, according to our data, 12.75% of the students were born in the U.S. The remaining of the population all were born in China. And they did come here in the U.S. at a different stage of their life. And in a few minutes, I can show you how long they have been spending, how many years they spend in this country. Okay, and also, just now, we talked about a very moderate educational expectation from the parents for our students. Now, let's look at their self-expectation. And we do see that this blue bar here indicates the previous parents' expectation for you to compare with their self-expectation. This blue green bar, this blue bar is a parent's aspiration towards students' educational attainment. And this red bar is the how far they want to go in the higher education. You can see all our students believe they can graduate from the college. And we have more than 60% of our students hope that they can get a master's degree at least. And there are very small percentage of them are uncertain about their future, but very small percentage. Now let's move to another different measure. How do they think the chance, how do they estimate the chance of achieve this educational attainment in the future? And this blue bar shows that. And we can see many of the students who do hope they can get into the graduate school, and they actually feel they have a little bit doubt about if they can go further than college education. But still together, we see this realistic estimate for the educational attainment is still much higher than what their parents had for them. Okay, now let's try to look at some other informations we collected to see why we see these very interesting stories for the school experience for our students. They do have a lot of oscillations and challenges, but they still can perform very reasonably or even strongly in school. So what led to this story? And this page shows the immigrant experience they had so far. And we know that many of the scholars argue that immigrants may perceive barriers from the different culture and different languages. Let's see how that works for our Fuzhounese students. Here, this table shows how long the students stay in this U.S. for all the foreign-born students. And we have, as we can see, actually they spend a reasonable, they stayed for reasonably years in this country. And we break the answers down to 3 years, 3 to 6 years, 6 to 12 years, or more than 12 years, in order to make it in line with the different educational stages people go through. We know this is not an accurate way to capture how long they spend in high school, in junior high, or in elementary school, but this is the best we can do here. And we do see there are less than 8% of the students spend less than 3 years in our in a U.S. High school, in the U.S., probably also U.S. high school. And there are 20% of our students spend between 6 and 3 years here. And 30% spend less than 12 years here, and 20% of them spend more than 12 years here. And in other words, sometimes we consider them as a group that immigrant were managed to immigrate into this destination at a younger age. And we may expect less challenges for them to be assimilated into the local culture. But they still come here after 12 years old or so, and they are not even considered as the one-and-a-half generation immigrant, right? And we do have 92% or more students who have a degree from a U.S. U.S. high school. That speaks for why we see an increase in admission from the Baruch College to this group. This U.S. high school diploma definitely helps, but still they are not the first, they are not the second generation immigrants, not even the one and a half generation here.
Excuse me. The number seems to be missing is about a quarter of the students. When they add up all the different...
Yeah, they don't add up.
There's still about a quarter.
Mm-hmm. 30, 50, 70, 80.
Yes, because this is about all the foreign-born students. We still have certain students who were born in this country. Yeah, and there is a small percentage of missing data here.
So the percentage you're giving is based on all the students?
Yes.
Not just the foreign-born?
No. Not only the foreign-born students, among all students.
So, I mean, one of the things I find really interesting about this mm-hmm. that I think, now of course, these numbers don't start from the day they start college. Mm-hmm. So you don't want to count 3 years back from age 18. I think, right? It's mm-hmm. we're starting from 20 or
right.
21. Mm-hmm. So almost 8% of the students in our population did not graduate from a U.S. high school. That means they're coming directly from Fuzhou and into the Baruch College system. That's a tremendous transition that they're making in terms of educational systems and language use. Another 21% are coming in directly from China into U.S. high schools. So that means that somehow in the course of a year to 3, maybe 4 years, they're having to make a transition from Chinese educational system where they're not speaking any English.
Okay, now let's try to look at the whole picture together. And we talked about the family backgrounds and family resources available for our students, and we also had a general overlook about the school performances and experience for the students. We see a lot of challenges, but despite the fact that the students were coming from a lower social class, and they lack of the social capital provided by the parents and investment from the parents, and they were coming into Baruch College with limited skills in terms of language and culture, and they experienced high levels of social isolation. They still can really survive and perform in this college. Why that happens? And we see in the literature, many scholars provide social capital and as one of the explanations for students' school performances. And we do not see that so work so strongly for the Baruch College parents. And how about the social capital actually can generate it by the students? Yes, we did see many evidence in this picture. For example, we can see the students can use many of those community or family or school level resources. And talking about the school level, and we have the questions asking students, how did you hear about Baruch or make your choice of major? And we see more than 50% of our students said that I heard this or I discussed with my friends. Okay, so this is the isolated social network they are having. But still, they performed very strongly as a new and individual level social capital for them. And the second top answer we got is from the high school chancellor, counselor. Yes, mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
Great.
And we see that they are their parents are not having the access to many of the school policy or culture, but they can, and they utilize that. And we also see many of the students, they were from the traditional Fuzhounese enclave neighborhoods, right? And that is why they grown up with all these peers, and they can come to the same school with these peers together, right? And in our classroom, we see always students sitting together with each other, sometimes chatting, doing translation for each other. And afterwards, after the class, and they discuss the project, and they hang out together, right? They do use this social network and the family school resources as a way to generate the social capital that's not available from their parents. And we also have questions about who will you turn to when you need help for the schoolwork. And still, not surprising, top one answer is for their peers, their friends. And very, very few students report that they will ask for this, their parents. And some of them may say that they can discuss with the siblings, but very few of them can get any help from the parents. And also, they are not working. And they do invest heavily in terms of time and energy in the schoolwork. That helps them to get a really strong, very strong GPA here. Okay, after that, we want to also show you a picture, quick picture about the special challenges our students experience. In this picture, you may see many of the struggles they are working with can reflect this special situation they brought, they are experiencing in family and in school. First, we see the academic challenges that from their initial skill package, and also we see the family, the stress from the family side, and also through this language barrier. And okay, so we see a few measures here. The top one measure indicates the top reasons for students why did they choose to come to Baruch. And we say we can see the top one response we get here from a strong business school education. They were coming here to go to pursue a business major. By the way, we asked them to choose three major reasons why they came here. So you do see add up together those percentage more than will get more than 100. The second reason they came here is it's affordable. We do have students constantly came to us, especially in their first year, explaining their situation. And they were ready to go to pursue the education from a more elite institute, as the stereotypical image of Chinese American students may do, but they were not able to support, their family were not able to support them, and they choose a public senior college in New York City, that's Baruch College. Okay, the convenient location for Baruch College in the midtown of Manhattan counts for 50% of the all response for why they choose came here. Of course, the reputation for academic reputation for the college is another 40% of our response. Okay, we also asked questions on things students found most beneficial to them after they joined in Brook. If this school experience worked out exactly as what they expected, and we got slightly different, actually quite different reactions. And they believe the top one most helpful thing they found out about Brook is its location. It's really convenient. That's not only offer a daily easy commute, it's also offer a opportunity for many of the internship and work opportunities that's coming to the campus because of this easy location. And affordable tuition is remains as one of the major benefits they enjoy. School strong business school still stay here, and financial aid provided by Baruch College through different programs is another big help they found. Of course, life and job opportunities in New York, and college support for job and internship application. And finally, they mentioned this word, cultural diversity, from Brook. They feel very comfortable in staying in this college, even they only hang out with their own folks. They still feel a more comfortable environment in classroom and outside the classroom in general. Okay. Finally, we asked the major stressors they experienced during the school years. And we found, well, even we see this is not a group typically have a high workload while studying, and they still report they struggle between the work and schooling. And another struggle is from this stress about pursuing personal interests or to fulfill the family expectation in deciding a major. Normally speaking, the family still hope the students go to the business side, can get an easy job that can make them a professional, can fulfill the upward mobility dream of the whole family, and can survive in this American society. But many of our students, after tasting the different fields, and found they were not really interested in business, but most of them still chose business in order to respond to this family responsibility they believe they have. Okay, the pressure from speaking in the classroom is another major stress. Many of the professors grade the students' performances based on different requirements, and participation in the class discussion is a big one, especially for the business classes. And many students feel, in terms of language barrier, culture barrier, and even the personality, and they feel very challenged in this field. And culture and language barrier are also on our top choice here. Okay, so this so far I presented a picture about our students, what kind of family resources they have, and what kind of self-support they manage to achieve. And eventually, they show us a very big picture about the special need, special challenge, and also strong school performances. Now, Professor Ken Guest will keep talking about a few conclusions that we want to make and some confusions that we want to solve and things we want to tease out through this conversation between us and you.
Mm-hmm. Well, we look forward to taking some questions and having that conversation. I think, as I said earlier, our goals with the study have been, one, to provide a much clearer picture of the Fuzhounese students at Baruch for our own college as we seek to serve them better and enhance their educational experiences. I think more generally, we want to unpack this concept of Chinese American and to bring this very unique population into a clearer focus in the larger conversations in social sciences. And then I think for us to begin to push on this question of, you know, what leads to this success? There's been so many conversations about the Chinese as the model minority. That is such a complicated theoretical framework, and clearly our students are not representative of that model. They come from very, very different backgrounds, and they're accessing a very different ladder for educational success. So they also, as Professor Liang has mentioned, don't have tiger moms at home, they're not studying. They don't have parents hovering all the time over their after-school activities and building their resumes to go to the elite school. So some of the common things to think about in terms of why these students are successful getting to Baruch don't fit with some of the realities of our students don't fit with some of the popular models and conversations. So we're sort of looking at some of the unique ways that students are mobilizing social capital, both in terms of social capital, meaning the resources that they have that are not economic. So financial capital is what you have in the bank. Social capital is all the other resources you draw upon to get ahead, to succeed, to survive. And so we think they have some pretty unique strategies for mobilizing that kind of social capital. Certainly the ethnic enclave that has been discussed in terms of the Chinese community provides immediate access to information, to resources. Certainly the Chinese newspapers that are represented here tonight are a key piece of accessing information and learning about SAT cram schools, and a lot of your advertisers are those kinds of schools. So there are ways in which the infrastructure of the Chinese community provides a kind of social capital to these students as they seek to move ahead towards school. And then this their common language, their common background as very recent immigrants, many of them, well, with the exception of the 13%, the other 87% born outside of the U.S. So some very common experiences that allow them to connect and bond. And so we see this kind of mobilization of social capital very very clearly in our classrooms. As Professor Liang's mentioning, the Fuzhounese students sit together, they hang out together in the hallways, they seem to be eating together on a regular basis. They tend to do projects together in class and submit things together. And so this is clearly, people are taking care of each other and they're utilizing those networks to get along and to get by in environments where English is not really their primary language, and their exposure to U.S. educational systems can be quite limited. The parallel to that, however, is that we're finding that drawing upon the social capital of their friends and colleagues at Baruch is not just a positive strategy, but it's a strategy which leads to some unique challenges. So we're also seeing, as we've laid out in the data, some intense isolation that is happening here, and that very same drawing upon social capital to survive and actually do quite well in classes is also leading to some pretty intense isolation. Now, what we see in our observations and our conversations with students is one very direct result is that their verbal English is not very good. They are students at Baruch College, but they struggle to communicate in class verbally and in writing. So this is not being stretched and tested through communication with folks from other language groups, there's this parallel between using the social capital to get along and the way that the same kind of social capital usage limits them and is really restricting the experience that they can have and the resources they're going to have to take beyond Baruch. So certainly the language is one piece of that, and I think also the just the engagement and incorporation and interaction with people from outside of their community while they're at Baruch. It's such a diverse place that's still not part of their experience of American student life. That diversity is not part of what they're engaged in, and so these are the two sides of the kinds of strategy that they've used. So we're trying to still explore that and see how that pushes ahead some of the literature on educational attainment. In the Asian American community.
So, I mean, we define it as isolation, but how do we know that that's how they feel? Maybe they're happy with their own group. I mean, I don't see any difference between when I was in grad school and there were tons of these international students in the program who couldn't get along or who couldn't communicate with the English speakers in the program. Mm-hmm. And these are highly educated. They come from very wealthy families overseas, but they stay together because they just couldn't communicate with the rest of us.
I have the same feeling. Mm. You have been repeating the social cultural isolation. I was thinking about all Asian Americans. This society is very racially divided. Mm-hmm. People choose to hang out with their own kind. Obama has a black wife and all his best friends and advisors are black. Would you say that Obama is culturally isolated? I don't think so. So I think it's just the natural gravitation, whether you're highly educated, whether your English is excellent or not. You just hang with your own kind. Asian Americans have their own student club and they join the project together. Mm. So that's one question I have about, I don't feel comfortable when you keep using the term like that. Mm. Number two, I tend to have a different understanding of their self-esteem. My understanding, talking to a lot of the older people, they don't want to speak Fuzhounese topic because they don't want people to know they're Fuzhounese. Mm-hmm. And it's a real big problem mm-hmm. among these younger generation mm-hmm. because of all the negative press, always about, you know, smuggling, Sister Ping and all the gangsters. And so they don't want people to know and they identify with Hong Kong culture or whatever. So I think that doesn't seem to reflect in your study about they have a very strong sense of identity and self-worth. It's not my understanding of the situation.
Mm. Are there other thoughts and comments?
I agree on the piece that because depending on, I would work with a lot of the Fuzhounese patrons, especially the young generation. They would try hard, not to speak the Fuzhounese public, even mm-hmm. they don't want people to know their family correct. Came from Fujian. Mm-hmm. So I think you do that PPT, you use more words like a lower, less,
yeah,
you, and that I think really affected the Fuzhounese so well. I don't know the student, when they go to the good school, I think they feel like they came that kind of family or something. More pressure or the fact that they are like a network or something, they just want a group of
Also, there are big differences in economic strata, differences mm-hmm. among the Fuzhou themselves. People who have been here longer versus people who have been here. Mm-hmm. They own several restaurants and many of them end up in Ivy League colleges, mm-hmm. send them to Harvard, Yale, mm-hmm. and they're trying to be very active in the political process right mm-hmm. now too. But the more far-sighted parents who has been established, they bring their kids to meet with politicians and have debates in mm-hmm. Chinatown just to expose them to the political process. So, mm-hmm. I think yours probably is more the new immigrants rather than the more established ones.
Well, I think that's what we're seeing at Baruch is that that Baruch is an access point for a certain part of the population, and it's a very specific part of the Fuzhounese population that's there. It's this 87% of them are immigrants themselves, and I think your comment is correct, and I'm about the way. It's interesting that the students feel very comfortable amongst themselves and in our conversation here identifying themselves as Fuzhounese. But I think you're absolutely right. Many of them have also expressed it to us their reluctance to identify themselves mm-hmm. in our classes mm-hmm. As Fuzhounese, and because there is a they experience a kind of discrimination within the Chinese community, mm-hmm. And they have experienced that consistently mm-hmm. through the high school process, mm-hmm. and that's an issue between the people of mm-hmm. Taiwanese descent, Cantonese descent, and Fuzhounese descent, and the FJs as they're called mm-hmm. Get all kinds of they get it handed to them on the playground for being less cultured, less educated. We could go on about so, but I think you're absolutely right that they struggle with that. So it's interesting that at Baruch they do rely on this their cohort to provide that kind of sense of support and the question of whether that's just the same as your grad student colleagues is what I'm experiencing here with our students is that it's really serving as this is a great way for them to find the support and networking to do well in school, but it's really inhibiting their capacity, I'm afraid, of functioning afterward
Do they feel they're limited as is, they can't see beyond that. I'm thinking they can't see beyond their limitations at this point. Mm-hmm. Do they feel that they're isolated, or do they think, well, this is fine, I have my network, I have my mm-hmm. friends, I don't need to go beyond that. I mean, there's no expectation that they'll work at Goldman Sachs. I think mm-hmm. we know that.
Well, they will, but they won't work in the front.
Right, correct.
So, I mean, that's the difference. They'll be in the back. And that's mm-hmm. the language issue. Mm-hmm. And that's the concern I have as we work with these students is mm-hmm. that as at Baruch, we would like them to work in the front office mm-hmm. and to be able to assist them. And it's just one of those challenges that they have. I don't know if Susan wants to speak to her experience.
That we are well aware of the fact that if they stay with the own group only and don't try to move forward, yes, they'll wind up being back office worker, and that is exactly what we do not want. So in the SIG office, what we do is that we provide them with a whole lot of support, especially with the verbal skills. We have a speech or communication specialist that works with them individually as well as in group. So they get to practice their verbal skill, and they're with me for one whole year as their counselor in the freshman seminar, when they have to start consenting. From the very first semester, they have to work together with other students. I do not allow them to self-select. I put them in different groups, so they have to work with students from other part of China. So yes, we are aware that we're trying to do that, and that's one of the reasons why we partner up with Ken to do this study, because we want to be able to provide the services that this population needs so that they don't wind up working in the back office only.
It's an interesting parallel to the kind of larger conversations that have happened over the last couple of decades about the role of Chinatown and in the Chinese community. So for some of the early scholarship in the late 80s, early 90s, the conversation was Chinatown is an ethnic enclave and it provides mm-hmm. a kind of opportunity for new immigrants that they would never be able to receive if they had to function in the primary economy. Mm-hmm. So it's a secondary economy of ethnic businesses with restaurants and garment shops and construction trades and now nail salons. And if folks had to go out and try to work at Macy's, they couldn't get the job because of language skills, just unfamiliarity. So that was part of the conversation, that the Chinatown ethnic enclave was a positive factor in people's incorporation or assimilation. Now, part of the critique that Peter Kwong and I worked on with that is that while it does provide opportunities for people to mobilize that social capital to get along and survive, it's actually a trap for a lot of folks because there's no way out of it. Mm-hmm. Because you're working solely in ethnic businesses and shopping in ethnic stores, then you don't really have the kind of engagement with the primary economy that allows you to transition. And so So while some people do succeed quite well, there's a large percentage of folks who really get trapped in that. And so that's kind of what I'm thinking, I'm looking at here as well, that this mobilization of social capital within their ethnic network is allowing them to do pretty well here. And certainly the strategic use of the ethnic networks to get into Baruch. The strategies around getting an SAT score up to 650 or 7 or 730. That's a very interesting strategy, you know, because they've figured out that CUNY doesn't look at GPA. CUNY doesn't it's an SAT score driven admissions process. So if you can get to 1100 or 1050, right? So there's ways in which the community has been used that way, but that doesn't necessarily help them integrate into the mainstream.
I can't see your point, but I just wanted to kind of put on.
Sure.
I just want to echo what the other two person was saying. I think there's some discomfort in the way it's being labeled, especially the word isolation has negative connotations. And there's some kind of value judgments there. I think it would probably be better to use a more neutral term to describe the phenomenon. Because, when you talk about social isolation, the way you define it is by them, asking them what are their significant others, what are their best friends. Mm-hmm. And, if you do a study with, say, African Americans or Hispanic Americans or white Americans, and you ask them who are their best friends, who are their significant others, if possible, you may get another, a similar type of answers. So without those data, you really cannot compare whether this group is more isolated or less. And not everyone needs to go to Goldman Sachs.
I hope nobody goes to Goldman Sachs, really. I mean, that's just not my goal for them at all.
I'm perfectly happy staying in Chinatown. Mm-hmm. And that should be okay. Mm-hmm. So I think there's some kind of discomfort, in the way it's being labeled, mm-hmm. and I also see some of the slides that I feel a little uncomfortable. It seems to reinforce the stereotype of Chinese Americans. For example, by labeling a caring environment, just by two parents, staying at home. That's a caring, supportive environment. I don't think you can jump to that conclusion. And, it's just a big surprise. I'm sure.
Thank you.
I noticed that there was no talk about gender. And I wonder whether that was on purpose or whether you haven't looked at this or just exactly why was it left out.
I just don't think we've gotten to that stage.
Okay.
Thank you. But thank you. Thank you for pointing out the glaring omission in the presentation tonight. Sure, and then we have somebody else who hasn't had a chance yet.
I want to make one comment. We have been interviewing a lot of Chinese American adolescents and sort of young adults. And among the Cantonese speakers, we have been asking them, what would happen if you bring home and then comes a list of people as a person you want to marry?
I ask my students that same thing.
And we're also asking them, what do your parents think about various Chinese groups? And I was surprised how negative and pronounced the reports of the students about their parents' stereotypes against Fuzhounese are. It is almost unbelievable. It's like going to northern Italy and asking people about Sicilians. That's how it sounds to me. Right? So when we heard about some people saying, I don't want to let people know that I'm from Fuzhou, or I can't imagine why.
That's
too bad, that's the situation.
Yeah, thanks for pointing that out. Actually, I have another addition on this issue. I know that many people found that Fuzhounese students or people in general feel not so comfortable in identifying themselves in public. Actually, we can see certain evidence from the data. For example, our top one most frequently spoken language outside the classroom is Mandarin Chinese, and the second most frequently spoken language is English. And the Fuzhounese is really a very low percentage, around 10% or so. And this speak more Fuzhounese at home, of course, for multiple reasons. And almost 50% of them identify themselves as Chinese, not Fuzhounese, only Chinese. Right, so that also kind of reflect one of this issue you two are talking about, and I think one of the reasons why we are so interested and excited about this self-image, positive self-image story is we see this self-image is very complicated rather than only one layer of culture meaning of being Fuzhounese. And these students realize they are from Fuzhounese family, but they also well realize the fact that they are among the first people in the family coming to a college and coming into a very decent college. And they are among the first generation that actually get a chance to go outside the Chinatown community, right? So their identity or self-image is really include those multiple meanings and multiple dimensions.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. One thing as a policy analysis, the things that worries me is that a majority of the students have so-called U.S. government grant. Pell Grant, and then they identify themselves most as Chinese. Okay, so I think you need to really look at the data and see how was it asked, because identity can be very fluid. Okay, so they could identify themselves as a Fuzhounese, identify themselves as Mandarin speaking, identify themselves as a Chinese. But in what context you ask? Under the context of Baruch as a college or whatever. So I think, who's asking the question? Who are the researchers? Okay, that's very, my student will say, oh, I'm Chinese. That's because they identify with me. And I was like, no, I'm Chinese American. And he was like, I'm also Chinese American. And then it was like, oh, I was born in China. But anyways. So this kind of discussion, I think particularly we have to be very, very careful. Because allocation of funding at this time is very important, and you release the data, majority of them get our grants, and they identify themselves as Chinese. What are we doing here?
Wait, I don't understand. Chinese lives in China, or a Chinese is your ethnic, your cultural?
So it's not Chinese American. They identify themselves as
Fuzhounese or Chinese. That's about 80%. The question was, what is your primary identification?
Mm-hmm, yeah. First, just a technical response to this question.
Yes.
How did we collect this information? This information is collected through the survey questionnaire. When we gave the questionnaire to the students and we explained the purpose of this, sometimes not in person, it's on the first page of this questionnaire, there is an explanation about the purpose, why we want to study Fuzhounese students in particular. And I think we hope that information well delivered, and then the students were required to finish the questionnaire alone, either at home or in a conference room we provided. There is no researchers in presence. Yes, but they.
I understand the situation, again, it is because this particular answer. Have a very strong implication later in future allocation of funding. If they see a lot of students we are educating in a public institution identify themselves, particularly the first generation, or they don't even they identify themselves as Chinese, and then so again you reinforce the idea that forever. Eternal.
Well, what's interesting about this population, and that is very different than the general immigration literature is that the general immigration literature shows that in the second generation, people, there's a complete shift. And this is, these are primarily not second generation. These are really still first generation students. But I understand, and certainly as an anthropologist, we know identity is fluid, and you can be a different, you can identify yourself differently in different contexts on a same day.
I think when they apply for Pell Grant, they all identify themselves as Asian American. They all show their green card.
Yeah, the residents should be fine. You don't need your citizen for them.
Well, and a part of the public school system is part is seen as also part of the assimilation, incorporation, and an adaptation system.
Sure.
So anyway, Tommy.
I think she's the next.
Oh, sure. There was somebody who hadn't been called on before. So, but go ahead. How's our time? What's our? I know we were supposed to go till 8. Is that? Are we okay going a little longer?
We have another 5 minutes.
Okay, great.
When I was just listening to you talk about, when you talk about cultural limitation, when I see it, it's not really just about like, I get what you mean, because you see these students, they maybe all have similar background. When you interact with people who have similar background, it could be either race, class, or just similar family background, anything. It's more about like, when you interact with someone, let's say I'm interested with someone who's Hispanic who came from Mexico. It's about like myself being exposure to different ideas, to different experiences. So I think when I was just listening to you, I think what you're saying is more like these students are only talking to people in this specific group, and that's what they're comfortable with. But let's say if they try to step out of this circle, they talk to someone, let's say, someone who's not Chinese or someone who came from Europe and then studied at Baruch, sometimes they'll be exposed to just different ideas. And I think that's, valuable about interacting with someone from your completely different background.
Thanks.
One of the choices, they value the diversity, that's why they came from Baruch.
Sure. Yeah, there's a question in the back.
I have a question, more like a comment, I guess.
Great.
I think this focus on this kind of like ethnic tension, or inter-ethnic tension, or this focus on like tension between Cantonese and Fuzhounese, seems to take away from like our, this kind of like larger framing that goes on outside of so the way that like, you know, stories about Fuzhounese are framed in the Chinese newspaper. Stories of how, like, you know, undocumented immigrants are framed in the newspaper. I think those stories and how they are framed affect how these kind of like, tensions arise, right? Like, so, you know, I learned that, you know, from my parents or from wherever, that, oh, Fuzhounese people do this and do that. And that kind of creates this kind of like stereotypes and stuff. So I think if you want to talk about these kind of like identity politics, we need to focus on these kind of larger things that are going on that's kind of causing these kind of tensions. I'm just like, you know, that's something that could be more research could be done.
Thanks.
Thank you so much for the fascinating talk. I have two questions. First, you mentioned about ethnic media, so I'm wondering, is there the churches, you know, the religious organization, they do play any roles in their economic performance? I mean, how their religious network, you know, overlapping or like, you know, come up to their like personal and school, you know, network. I mean, like, you know, those students, they might be, you know, already connected through church before they enter into the school. So I'm just wondering, you know, how, you know, ethnic church play in their, this whole, you know, native people, you know, second generation, you know, academic performance. That's my first question. The second question is, when the Fuzhounese immigrants, when they immigrate to the United States, they tend to immigrate as a family unit, or they come as a, like, an individual. I mean, like, you know, they don't have, you know, enough resources, and then still they want to bring their family when they first come to the U.S.
The second one is easier, I think.
Family, even though they don't have resources right away, maybe they have like intergenerational aspirations from the beginning. Maybe even though I'm not poor, but I'm dreaming better life for my children, so that I'm bringing their family. So like I'm thinking like even though their parents are like restaurant workers, they already imbue their intergenerational aspiration to their children, so they children might be like encouraged. So I'm just wondering.
Vivian Louie wrote a whole book called Compelled to Excel about that idea that parents then work so hard with the idea that their children will be able to excel and that they actually compel them to do that to make up for their sacrifices or in response to their sacrifices. So I don't know. It's certainly part of the mythology of the of the Chinese migration that, and actually not just Chinese, but of immigrants in the United States, that people are willing to give up their lives and so for the future generation. And I don't know what our psychologists would say about that. I think it's maybe more complicated than that, but it's certainly part of the narrative. What I've seen in terms of the migration process, it's usually someone comes first. And they, if they're the first person in the family, they have to then establish some. They have to pay money to get smuggled in. Hopefully, getting some kind of citizenship, or then mobilizing the resources to get the next person brought in. So it tends to be quite chain related, and not just directly nuclear family chain related, but a very broad, extensive, extended kinship network. So, and I think that your other question around what role do the ethnic religious communities play in their academic success? I think that's a great question. I mean, I know from my work in some of the in the Fuzhounese churches, they work very hard to cultivate the young adult group. It's very different and distinct population than the new immigrant Chinese young adults, young people. The young adult group may meet, but you've got folks who are in the college track and people who are in the restaurant track, and it's a very different, difficult conversation. But I think that the churches are very determined to produce professionals who will enhance the reputation of their own faith perspective, and to be able to bring those resources back. I remember it being at the Church of Grace, and they were constantly trying to recruit people to go become lawyers, so that they could have some lawyers in-house to help all the other people who are coming. I think they certainly, now how broad an influence that is on the larger population, that's a harder question to answer.
Hi.
I just want to say, I talk with a lot of Fuzhounese patrons, because my job is working that big Fuzhounese community. I think a lot of family, they know they are no adequate resources, still bring their family members, they say, mostly inconsiderate for their kids. They say they didn't get a chance to get a good education for their kids. So once that, I think it's really good news I want to bring to here, because the particular bigger Fuzhounese neighborhood in Park, and this branch
is
books of circulation in the whole Brooklyn Public Library system, 58 branch, every year is not the number one, it's number two. So that is we can see, and the young generation, the family, Fuzhounese family, they push their kids, the education is very hard. So that is a particular branch, and the Fuzhounese come to borrow the book. It's not like a few. They most a lot of family bring the suitcase and the shopping cart, I tell you. So that's why that branch, when we open and close, the checking a checkbox, the line seems never finished.
Excellent.
When we're busy, our branch, the people come to help, they always say, when we work one day in your branch, we go home, don't even want to take a dinner directly, go to the back. I think this is a very good trend for this young generation. We realize that the education is very important. So I think maybe few years later, your book about the Chinese percentage will be broke very high.
I hope so.
I want to thank you very much, and you bring a lot of information, gave to and enlighten me the, how to provide good services for the big Chinese companies.
Well, and we want to thank you all for the really wonderful conversation, for the correctives, for pushing back on some things, and this is an ongoing interest of ours and a study in process. So we will take your thoughts and very seriously. We look forward to talking to you. If you have more thoughts, you can reach us through the Institute or on our Baruch College website. We'd be delighted to talk and think some more. Thank you very much.
Thank you.